Hello, Andrew Wasson from creativeguitarstudio.com. Today we're talking about learning guitar and, most importantly, the wrong ways to go about doing this. Because there are some popular methods that I believe are an incredible waste of time, and I want to make sure you guys realize that. But I'm not going to leave you without what I think is the best approach overall, so you guys don't end up wasting your time doing the wrong things. Our first guitar learning area is going to focus on picking technique, and then we're going to go over to the fretting hand and examine that as well. And those two areas are so important when you're developing your groundwork as a player, because once you can get your hand technique together, the rest of the elements of playing will slowly start making more and more sense. Before we start, I want you to look at these three ways of picking over here. We've got picking methods that are common to students who learn on their own, and also common ways that I've seen students get shown to them by teachers. We've got the forearm rotation, the low elbow hinge, and the three-finger grip. Now, if you were able to focus on just one of these, which one do you think would lead to the best picking technique down the road? I'll give you a few seconds to decide. Now, if you follow me, you already are going to know I don't like the forearm rotation, and the elbow hinge is not going to offer you accuracy, and the three-finger grip leads to sloppy playing. So all three of those methods are terrible ways to learn how to pick notes on the guitar, and that also includes strumming as well. But I've seen all of them taught either on YouTube videos or from players who are going at learning guitar on their own, especially the idea of people saying that you should strum guitar from your elbow. I mean, that's just absolutely ridiculous. Every time I see somebody on a YouTube video say that, I just question where they ever learned how to play and who taught them, you know, how to do anything in terms of proper rhythm guitar. It doesn't make any sense to me whatsoever. So whether you're a beginner or an intermediate guitarist, you need to learn the habits that promote good, accurate guitar playing. All right, so to properly develop your picking, I'm going to start off here by suggesting a picking practice approach that focuses on holding the pick the right way, which is basically between two fingers, the thumb and the index finger. Have that side of the edge of the index finger be where the pick is sitting, and then bring the thumb over top, and just have that grip between the thumb and the index finger just like that. The secondary thing I need to move into is the playing action itself. Now, this is really important here that the wrist becomes the main proponent of your picking. You want the picking action to come from the wrist here. And that's also in, you know, terms of strumming as well, if you're strumming chords. You want all that to happen right from the wrist area, not from the elbow. I know some of the YouTube videos out there will say you want to pick from your elbow. It's just absolutely ridiculous. It's too big of a muscle group. You're not going to get accuracy that way. So you want minimal movement of the elbow and minimal movement of the fingers. You might have some tracking movement. It might be very, very small though, but that's just to be able to track the pick to the different string sets. That's all that the elbow group and the fingers would ever be doing. And the next thing I need to talk about here is picking itself, how you're going to be approaching it. If you're an absolute beginner and you're just starting out on guitar, it's all brand new for you, I'd highly suggest that you just pick with downstrokes. Just downstroke picking in the very, very early days. But once you even achieve a little bit of accuracy and picking starts becoming more refined for you, switch as quickly as you can to using alternate picking. That's the down and up. Down and up picking, alternate picking, is the most efficient style. There are other more advanced forms of picking like rake picking, sweep picking, economy picking. All that stuff is fantastic, but it's a whole other realm of picking. The basic idea would be down picking, up picking, and down and up combination, which is what we call alternate. Now, another area that's really important to work on is having your pick strokes remain very short. You know, if you pick a note and your guitar pick only moves off the string slightly, it's going to be much better for the return to the string again, rather than as if you picked a note and your pick moved quite far away from the string. You've got a lot of dead air space to make it through before you can strike the string the next time. So that's really important. Very short picking strokes. That's going to help for accuracy and, of course, for speed as well. Now, last part I want to get into here with you is giving yourself a sense of security of exactly where the tip of that guitar pick is, because a lot of people have trouble with that, and they'll come up with ways to try to solve that by, you know, one of the most popular is anchoring. You know, they'll anchor fingers onto the pick guard, which is really bad. It creates a ton of tension in the hand. Sometimes the heel of the hand will go and anchor onto the bridge. I've seen that many times. Again, it's any kind of an anchor point produces stress and tension on the muscle groups, and it does slow you down. You need that, you know, sort of openness and ability to, you know, go at it with the action happening from the wrist. And the only way to really achieve that is to use what we call a lot of times a brushing technique. And how that works is that if you're playing on higher strings, let's say top three strings up here, what you're going to do is you're going to use the heel of your hand to lightly brush on any of those low strings that aren't in use. It's going to act as a muting technique as well. So you'll be able to play on the upper strings, and you'll have a good accuracy level because the brushing effect that you'll have on those lower strings will really tune you in to where the, you know, tip of that guitar pick is at all times. Now, when you switch gears and you go to these lower guitar strings, when you're picking on them, what you can do is you could use the top of your small finger to lightly brush on the upper strings and give you a sense of security, again, where the tip of that pick is for those low notes that you're going to be hitting on the low strings. So all of these ideas I just shared with you are going to do two things. They're going to increase your accuracy, and in the long run, as you develop speed, they're going to increase your speed as well. All in all, it comes together to really bump up your level of ability with picking tenfold as compared to if you didn't integrate any of these ideas at all. Now that we've discussed how to fix three of the worst picking hand technique issues, next up, I want to move on and discuss the fretting hand. Now, on this side of the guitar, I've noticed two horrible ways that students either learn to fret notes on their own, or how they'll perhaps even get taught how to fret notes by some YouTube video, maybe by a private instructor. Take a look at these two videos and tell me if you can spot a couple of problems that are going on here. Now, in the top video, the fret hand's palm is grabbing the neck like it's a baseball bat. And that's not exactly the most balanced way of holding a guitar neck. And in the lower video, the notes are being fretted with the pads of each finger rather than from the tip. So if either of these sound like you, there's some practice that needs to happen to fix these areas. The fretting hand always operates the absolute best when we have three elements going on: a high level of relaxation, you know, pretty much zero tension, and the use of the tips of the fingers to play the notes, as well as a really good support in the back of the neck from the thumb. Now, those are the areas I want to focus in on, because if we can get you up to the level of having really good control in each of those zones, you're going to play much better with your fretting hand. Accuracy, speed, it'll all increase. So first of all, relaxation, that's just all going to come from you becoming highly conscious and aware of what your hand feels like. You know, right from the forearm down into the wrist, your muscle groups of your fingers, and you have to understand what tension is like, and then what it's like to be relaxed. You could even think about that next time you go to the gym, and maybe when you're on the chin-up bar or something, it's a great way to develop your grip strength and to have a lot of tension in the hand and then relax and understand mentally what the difference is between the two, because you have to play relaxed. It's going to yield the best accuracy and the best, in terms of getting you faster in your playing as well. So relaxation, big understanding there to have that under your belt. Now let's move on also to the supportive element of having the thumb in the back of the neck. I'm just going to grab a pencil here. I want you to pay attention to the pad of that thumb and what it's like to be sitting in the middle of the back of the neck. I know a lot of the guitar books and all that, they'll say, you know, sit in the middle of the back of the neck. You know, well, I mean, yeah, that's okay, but sometimes that thumb is going to move around a little bit. One of the things you just want to keep in mind is that the knuckle of the thumb should be straight. You don't want it bent. And you also want to play, you know, with the thumb in the back of the neck where the pad is your supportive, you know, area in back there. So really important ideas there for that support in the back. And then when we come over to the front of the guitar as well, really important for that to have the tips of the fingers being playing right on the string rather than the pad of the finger playing at the string. That's one of the true causes of slowing people down is they're playing too much with the pad of the finger rather than the tip of the finger. So keep those elements in mind because, you know, if you can, you know, get a slight arch, you know, curve of the fingers onto the guitar string, that helps keep your hand more relaxed, by the way, as well. Slight curve to the wrist, so you're getting, you know, that arch again coming up. You don't want too much of a curve of the wrist, but it just depends person to person. I've seen some people, it looks like they have really a crazy arch of their wrist, but they're actually playing fine and they're telling me they're completely relaxed and, you know, everything they're doing sounds great. So, from person to person, no two people have the same, you know, genetic makeup and all their muscle structure and so forth. So you got to keep in mind sometimes what you're going to see people doing live on stage or maybe even in a YouTube video might look awkward or seem bizarre to you even, but for them, it's perfectly fine and it's working for them. So all of it boils down to being relaxed again, but, you know, some of these basic elements like using the tip of the finger to play your notes, keeping the good support in the back of the neck from the pad of the thumb, they are really the big factors. Now, I should mention something because there are exceptions to these rules because, you know, when you play down in the open position, what you're going to find, you know, you go to do a C chord or a G chord, you notice where my thumb is, it's gone up a little bit higher. You're going to find that when you play in open position, your thumb will be up a little bit higher than it would be in the middle of the neck. So your thumb will drop somewhat when you go into, let's say, third, fifth, seventh fret. Another thing, too, that's really important to understand is the rule of the playing with the tip of the fingers doesn't really apply if we're doing bar chords. You know, if you're doing a bar chord, you have to collapse the finger and you have to keep it very flat to be able to, you know, flatten out across multiple string sets and do the bar technique. So in order to execute those ideas, yeah, you got to break some of these rules we're talking about right now. But overall, those are just small exceptions and everything I have discussed here with to do with fretting hand, these are really the core elements. Well, the combination of all of these elements that I've run through here in this video are what I've been teaching and what I've been trained to do my whole life. I've taught this stuff to over 1,000 guitar players, and I know that these ideas work. I know they yield excellent results, but there's something else that you need to keep in mind. And I'll add this as a bonus tip for you here at the end. In order to make changes in the way that you're learning guitar, there needs to be a change to your mindset. A lot of guitarists try and get more serious about their technique, but they fail and they end up reverting back to their old bad habits. They'll second guess new ideas, they'll go back to their old ways because those old ways, even maybe if they're not very efficient, they're probably more familiar and they feel easier. But you can't do that. You can't revert back to inefficient methods of playing guitar the first time that you hit struggle. No method will work for you unless you change your mindset. So the first time you feel like you need to work hard and you need to really buckle down and get a lot of ideas happening in your playing that are new, don't quit. You know, if you slip up and you revert to your old ways, don't quit. Get back on track. You know, if you get involved in a course like mine at creativeguitarstudio.com that's more involved and it's a bit more of a hefty program to work through, don't quit at the first sign of struggle. Stay with it. You know, stay with the course. Continue working throughout the length of time that's going to be required to overwrite any bad habits with good ones. And I promise you, if you do this, that if you work on this really hard, it's going to all work out for you and it's going to work for you forever. Guys, if you found this video helpful, make sure you leave your comments and thumbs up below. And if you're looking for a step-by-step guitar program that puts real tested methods into a proven guitar course, not just random YouTube videos, it's all available over at creativeguitarstudio.com. And remember, you don't want to miss any of my guitar lesson videos, so turn on those notifications and subscribe to the channel. All right, guys, we'll be back here again real soon. Thanks for watching, and we'll see you on the next video. Bye for now.
When it comes to online guitar lessons, there's no place better than creativeguitarstudio.com. General membership to the site is always free, and paid memberships to access our step-by-step beginner, intermediate, and advanced guitar programs are offered in reasonable monthly and annual packages. Skype lessons are also available if you need more specific instruction one-on-one to discuss the finer details of your guitar playing. Sign up today at creativeguitarstudio.com.
I've got 25 years experience teaching guitar and have written a well-organized step-by-step guitar course. Head over to my website at creativeguitarstudio.com and sign up for a free membership today. Join the thousands of members worldwide who have already enrolled. There's no need to try learning the guitar on your own. Let me help you become the best guitar player that you can be.